We're told that all effort helps us toward fruitfulness, so we just have to have faith in that as we go along. It's like working out. We hit these down spells and we feel, oh, I'm not getting anywhere, but really we are. It's just we don't always feel so peppy. So we continue here to simply work. What else is there to do here in this world right now? Sit around and mope about the news? No way. We cannot do that. So we continue to work here, and I can start off by saying, looking at the dreams of last night, quite extraordinary dreams. I had these wild big cats, like leopards and tigers and such. There were these cats that were coming to my front yard, and I ended up going out there and interacting and then becoming friends with them, and then they became good friends with me, and all their wildness disappeared completely. And they were like house cats, big house cats. There was no more wildness at all in them. But it was quite a stressful dream. It was more than one. It was quite a number of these big cats coming home. Wildcatting, I guess, going, it represented this idea of trying to produce some narrative, a narrative for a new self. What, there is no new self. Our true oneself doesn't need any narrative at all. It's not based on narrative. It is the isness of God, the prime creator. So we're trying to create this narrative for some other self, a narrative for what doesn't exist, actually, thinking that we can infer. That we can infer that it exists, and somehow, through our will of inferring, that it somehow will magically then become existent, become real. So here we are, following all these wild narratives, wildcatting, going out and wildcatting, and all for nothing, all for no reason. So here come all these stories, all these storylines that I've sent out, like a cat in the jungle going out, and the cat is, trying to find its ways, having all these experiences in the jungle, all these dangers and opportunities, etc. Narrative, and now they're coming back home and they're just sitting down and just resting, and they're finished with all of that. So I welcomed them back, but it was pretty intense to go up to these powerful big cats, wild big cats, and pat them on the head and say, how are you doing, and be gracious and welcome them back home. And he just it's a little unnerving, for sure. The path can be somewhat unnerving. No, it's very stressful. It's the most difficult endeavor there is, and really, yeah. So it's those who are doing this should be applauded for it. No question about that. This tests our resolve. It's easy to run out in fear from the cats. Oh my God, there's these huge cats. Oh my God, that's terrible. Oh, bar the doors, get a gun, shoot all this stuff. Instead of going out there and saying, ah, how are you doing? Walking up to them, saying, and just say, let's be friends now. Let's no more of this wildcatting going on. And they're happy to come home, and we're happy to have them come back home. Call all our projections back home is what we're doing. But this is tests our nerve, and when our nerve is used up like this, we feel sluggish and tired, which is kind of frustrating because we don't want to really feel this way. But the fruit of all this effort is to ultimately experience the self, the one and only self, not the inferred self, the true self, which is not inferred from any narrative, any storyline whatsoever. These storylines are an attempt to infer some other self, a self of a different self than what than the true self, an imperiled self, a vulnerable self, a changed self, a different self, which doesn't exist at all. So we have no need to try to produce an inferred self. We don't have any need for that. It's a whim, not a need. We keep going over this. It's a whim, not a need. So we're schlepping along here, just said, oh boy, it's never easy. It never seems to be easy. because we keep reinvesting in progress and challenging ourselves every day. But what else are we to do as we wait for the end of the world, really? This is what we do. We don't want to just kick back and trust in the future of this world, which is an attempt to infer a changed self, a different self. And we try to do this through imperilment. So, of course, the world is dancing a dance of imperilment. There isn't any question about that. So, for sure, the future will be one of imperilment. It always has been, always will be here. I think it's foolish. It's foolish to try and trust in think, oh, yeah, the future is going to be so nice here. By what possible belief do we have that this is possible? This is pie-in-the-sky, egoic, wishful thinking, magical thinking. The dream of imperilment is the dream of imperilment. That's what it is. We can't change that. And now I'm going to be interrupted here. That's a pity. One moment, please. Okay. Problem. It gives a good time to take a deep breath here. For all of us to take a deep breath. So what we're doing is we're defying the world narrative entirely here, right? So this is not easy to do, but this is what we're doing. I'm not paying attention to the news. I'm not paying attention to what's happened. Well, I may want to find out where Zach Greinke signs the Giants or the Dodgers. But that's my little indulgence, I guess. Once that's over, okay, who's going to pay the $200 million or whatever? But we're not paying attention to the narrative of the world here. It doesn't matter. See, this narrative of the world is only for the purpose of trying to infer a changed self, a self different than the one that we actually are. That's the only reason all of this is taking place. What we see, what we're experiencing, this world we've imagined, actually, and are sustaining through our desire to experience it, to imagine it, is simply for that purpose. It's not for any other purpose. The one self, the natural self, doesn't have a purpose to try to reveal itself or try to change itself, or doesn't have any needs like that. Doesn't need to imagine a world, imagine bodies, imagine impermanence, imagine all this kind of stuff that's going on. It doesn't have any such need, actually, except it had a whim. It had a whim to see adventurous whim, but that's not a need. Adventurous whim cannot be a need. You might say that adventurousness is the only need we have, but that isn't stuck into the trying to change our adventurousness. Our freedom is our only need we have. We are free. But that doesn't mean then the freedom to change freedom is a need. That is not a need. There's no particular experiencing which is ever a need. None whatsoever. We can never say that what we need to experience this. There's no such thing in reality as needs like that. It's desire. It is for fun, for enjoyment, for adventure. But it's not. Never has it become a need, but we've gotten wrapped up in this belief that this is a need. It's not. It's not a need at all. But we do need, temporarily, a pragmatic temporary need is to recognize that it isn't a need. There are no needs in this regard. So we will continue to try as best we can here, feeling less than totally inspired for some reason. It's just the mood of the times, isn't it, that we just kind of, I guess it's just that people are reacting to news, and it's just a general sense that the world is not, is heavy upon us. So we have to lighten up. We have to lighten up. Do the lighten up, as I have said. And I have to do a better job of that. We all have to do a better job of that. And remind ourselves of that. Do the lighten up. So we will do the lighten up. Let us read the fourth chapter in this book, Spaciousness. It's not a long chapter. It won't take long. So we'll just give a little attention getting a bell here. As we say, okay, we are going to simply listen and get familiar, well, kind of slowly here, we're not in a big hurry. This is chapter 4, The Nature of Luminous Mind, by Longchenpa. Luminous mind is not appearance. It goes beyond appearance. It is not simply emptiness, it goes beyond emptiness. It is not truly existent, it has no concrete attributes. It is not non-existent, it pervades all samsara and nirvana. Neither is nor is not. Its unremitting sameness is pristine spaciousness. And without root, base, or substance, it is non-spatial and non-temporal. Pure presence, unbreakable, is the luminous matrix. Sky-like spaciousness, unalterable and unchangeable, saturates the now. As self-sprung awareness in the now, incommensurate in the now, unborn, unceasing, it is contained in the one soul sphere, indeterminate, all-embracing, it is zero-dimensional. The Vajra heart's core, motionless, unremitting sameness, all-suffusing, supreme spaciousness, neither doable nor undoable. This is not a domain that can be described in words. Insight welling up as the presence intrinsic in every field. The adept, free of discursive elaboration, vocal and mental, convinced that every field of experience is ineffable, entertaining neither meditation nor any object of meditation, need not eliminate either depressed or elated thought. In the reality of empowering being, in the now, where concepts of self and other do not govern us. The three realms in themselves are Buddha fields of sameness. The victors of all time are self-envisioned purity, and everything indiscriminately partaking of that totality. Not an iota of anything is to be attained elsewhere. All experience effulgent in the vast matrix of mind's nature. There is not the slightest movement out of actual sameness. Without inside or outside, without disturbing pulsation, luminous mind as the soul, as the source, dispels the darkness of extremes. And within the need, and without the need of doing anything, precludes any deviation. People's unrealized strobe-like perception in the mundane world and awareness of sublime forms in the now that is pure Buddha both arise within the creativity of pure presence. As non-congealing display permeated by sky-like spaciousness. Insofar as there can be realization of that spaciousness or its absence, realization affords the pure perception of blissful Buddha, while non-realization delivers the ignorant dualistic propensities that manifest multifariously, yet still never stray from spaciousness. Luminous mind is the actual condition of everything, and attributes uncrystallizing, no matter what their variation, it is evident as the pure spaciousness of inherently clear reality, without sharpness or blur, as unrestricted pure presence. The self-sprung spacious matrix is translucent awareness in the now. It is clear light unveiled without any outside or inside. Intrinsic presence is thus a marvelous mirror of mind. An intrinsic spaciousness is a precious wish-fulfilling gem. Since everything occurs naturally without any quest, self-sprung awareness in the now is the glorious source of fulfillment. Whatever innumerable transcendent qualities can be divined, all arise out of spaciousness as spaciousness, and all arise as sublime, non-crystallizing skillful means. As unborn spaciousness, everything is spontaneously perfected, all material things transfigured by the emptiness of the luminous matrix, the emptiness adorned by the intrinsic presence of the luminous matrix. In luminous mind in the now, there is no duality of appearance and emptiness. And in that non-dual detachment, far-out magical illusion appears. Unborn spaciousness, lacking any time frame, remains an immutable matrix, undivided and uncompounded. And Buddha of all time, as awareness of pure presence, a luminous matrix of intrinsic presence, saturating dualistic perception, without inside or outside, reality is spacious spontaneity. So this is a spiritual food. We should be on a spiritual food diet along with our normal diet, which I'm trying to continue. Spiritual food, the highest spiritual food. We should be feeding ourselves. Talk about health food. There's nothing healthier than this type of spiritual food that we just listened to. This is spiritual health food. I feel a lot of people in this world who are you know, on health kicks. They just do the body thing and forget the spirit. So why not do both? I'm not saying just do one and forget body health. I mean, why not do both? I'm doing both right here, right now. Back on a juice smoothie diet and reading from spaciousness. And we have to thank Keith Dowman for doing such a extraordinary work here, really. I don't know how he did it, really. The brilliance of Longchenpa it comes through. And who would have ever thought to think this way, really? I don't know. it's quite exceptional. Any way you look at it, any way you want to slice the pizza, it's quite good, quite tasty. This Longchenpa's way of expressing, I'm really nonplussed by it. It's just, you don't expect anyone, any conceptualization to be put into that sort of format. It's just, wow. It's very wowish, which is helpful for us. That's what we want. We want to come across a very, very wowish spiritual health food. Helen Schuckman did it, and William Tedford did a similar Similarly with A Course in Miracles, they what you know, how in the world were they able to put words in these kind of words together into these sentences and without just feeling, you know, whoa, where are we going with this? I don't. But you know, some have done extraordinary jobs to help us out, and I'm sure what they want is us to be helped by this. I mean, what good is it if someone goes to all this work and people say, "Oh, yeah, thank you, but we're not going to eat this spiritual food"? I mean, what good is that? I mean, that would bring a heavy heart to them, I'm sure. So we're honoring the work of those who have helped us out by working on it, eating this food. Eat this food. I mean, this is the real Eucharist. Is this information, right? That's what Jesus said. Eat this. He said, "My body and flesh is my teaching, and my practices I've given you." He has made that very clear. Actually, we've confounded it throughout history. It's been confounded, but really, it's still there. And I pointed out in other videos. He says the flesh profiteth nothing, nothing, nothing. And he says the words and that I've given you, this is the life and spirit and life that I've given you. So obviously he means to eat of, when he says to eat of me, he means his teaching, not his body and flesh, his teaching. So this, we're eating the teaching of Longchenpa here. That's spiritual flesh, as it were, but we don't need to use that term. It's spiritual nutrition. We're being properly fed by this type of teaching spiritually. We're getting our more than our daily allowance of, right, of the essential vitamins and minerals and carbohydrates and proteins spiritually. And people are simply not used to thinking of it in this way. They have a very difficult time here of even envisioning it in such a way. And we're breaking through this terrible barrier that's been up in the world. And it's like food. When we eat food, do we think about it after we've eaten it? You think about it and says, "Okay, what was that I ate? And what was the name of it? And what was the color of it now? And what was the constituency of it? And what was the chemical components that we do? Do we dissect our spaghetti? Or we say, no, I just ate spaghetti. Once I've eaten it, I don't have to ruminate about what I ate. It's the same thing here. We don't need to overly ruminate right at this point. It's already been ingested into our consciousness, spiritual awareness. And so just let us digest it. This is the wow. The wow is like a spiritual digestion, actually. Full stop on the wow. Let it digest. Don't throw it up and say, "Wait, I need to look. What did I eat again?" And we throw it. You throw up, regurgitate it like some bird and look at it and say, oh, is that what I ate? Oh, it doesn't look so good now. I don't think I want to eat it again. Don't regurgitate it. Let it just settle in here. Now at some point we can go over it more slowly and look at it, but that would be a different meal that we would eat. And again, do we eat one meal and immediately start another and another and another and just jam, get a stomach ache if we do that? So, spiritual eating is the most important eating on this planet. That's what Jesus told us. You must eat this body and this flesh, meaning his teachings. Otherwise, you won't get to the kingdom of heaven. You must pay attention. And he put it into the format of a meal because that's what we do here. We eat several meals a day. Everyone does, right? So, it's the most common activity we have in this world is eating. So, he put it into that context and said, just like you're eating a supper, spend equal amount of time considering my teaching. So you may sit down, and back then they had banquets and they may take a couple hours at the banquet. It's not, they're in a hurry. It's a big deal. I mean, I've ever experienced anything like that, but it probably is fairly enjoyable, except I can't eat a whole lot. But take a couple hours. So he's saying, take a couple hours and eat of the food that I have given you. My food is not of this world. My flesh, my body is not of this world. The teachings are not worldly teachings. They're not Old Testament teachings. Just as we listen to Longchenpa, we say, this is just, what is this? I mean, this is not your normal teaching, worldly teaching, is it? Not at all. So the ones that eat this spiritual food are the ones that get into the kingdom of heaven, the ones that recognize pure presence, that accept it doesn't need any narrative at all. It's not conditioned by any narrative. It's not held in place by any narrative. It's not influenced by any narrative. It doesn't have any narrative. In fact, it can never have a narrative. How can freedom have a narrative? How can pure freedom have a narrative? It's never a narrative. So as we just hear this and it sinks into us, we begin to accept it more and more and more. Say, oh, this is familiar to me. I can speak this way. I can think this way. I can accept this. This is the benefit. But again, Christianity points out, and to use an example, this has to be an everyday thing like eating. We eat every day. Almost all of us eat every day, even if it's not a whole lot. Similarly, we should eat spiritual food every day. We should pay attention. And Christians have tried to do this, reading the Bible every day. This has been a tradition. They read the Bible in the morning. Maybe they pray at lunch, and then dinner. After dinner, they read the Bible. It's part of your day to focus on that. It's a good habit. It's a good habit. Now, Jesus' teachings are a lot more clearly expressed in A Course in Miracles than they are in the Bible. A lot more clearly expressed. But this calls for a lot more discipline. I mean, the banquet table is there it is. There's the banquet. It's full. And so, you know, we go in and we start eating. And so this practice throughout the ages of doing this good habit, now we can just use that good habit to eat the big meal. Before it was just hors d'oeuvres, now the big meal's there. And then we're able to eat of this very, very strong dessert like Longchenpa. This is like dessert. It's very powerful dessert, very sweet dessert. And so this is what we do. This is what I've done. This is the way that I see it. This is the way. Your life you have to include attention to spiritual teaching like you include attention to eating food. Not there's a direct parallel, but just it's a metaphor. We go out, we get food, we buy food, we work, make money, get food, we prepare it, we eat it, we put all this attention ever we got to eat. The same thing with the spiritual teachings. We have to really actually pay just as much attention and put just as much importance, if not more, on ingesting the spiritual food as we do the mundane food. We don't try again to figure it out, what is said. It resonates. Let the resonation do its work. Resonation dissolves continuity fear. It's not our discursive thinking that dissolves continuity fear. It's the resonation that dissolves the continuity fear. It's the digestion, allowing the digestion. In this case, it would be like a resonation, like a big bell being rung, and we're just letting that gradually fade out. Ring the bell and then let it resonate and then let it fade out just naturally. And that's what dispels continuity fear, evaporates it. as this becomes more and more familiar to us, this is evaporating the continuity fear. We say, I don't fear this. This is common ground for me. And this is normal, familiar ground for me. I'm on home turf here. I'm on home turf. Why should I be afraid? Fear is the stranger here. Fear is the one that's the stranger here. Now, I'm at home with this. I'm not a stranger to this at all. This is tipping the balance, this gradual tipping of the balance. Familiarity is what's decisive in this pragmatic situation with continuity fear that we have. Familiarity is decisive. So there's no way around it. There's no way around it. People take drugs to try and speed things up, but I don't know anyone that's really worked for at all. It doesn't really bring familiarity. It may bring, wow, I had this far out realization, man, that we're all one, and there's no compoundment, and oh, I just saw this. But then later on in life, you see the tale has already been told about drug use, actually throughout history. We just think that the 60s just, invented it. They reinvented it, rediscovered it. But the tale has already been told. The data is already in. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. You see all these people from the 60s, and are they enlightened? No. No. Did they get back to, every day? Said, well, if they did, then maybe they will make it. But it's because of their dedication, everyday dedication, that they're going to make it. Not because they took drugs. It's not about altering anything. It's not about any narrative at all. It's about accepting that what we are is not in any way the result of any possible narrative or non-narrative. And getting used to this idea, and Longchenpa is bringing this into focus for us. He helps really bring it into focus. He's like a relief pitcher. It helps finish off the game. Really, really, he keeps fine-tuning this focus for us, this all-important issue here. And this supersedes all of the regalia of tradition, really. Just as A Course in Miracles supersedes also the regalia of tradition, we don't need any of that. That's all our belief in a narrative, which only brings up inference in our minds. It suggests inference because it suggests nothing else. There isn't any self that this narrative is based on, so how could it not suggest inference, inferring a self from it? So it's automatic inference. Now, as far as inferring a domain or a realm, the Holy Spirit takes care of that. Once we see that this is much ado about nothing, we say, yeah, well, we want to honor our creativity, so the Holy Spirit will show us a vision of the real world, of the death-free realm, some sort of beautiful vision that still incorporates our creativity in it. But that only infers reality. See, this is an inference of reality. Now, reality doesn't need any inference of itself. It's only when we try to change reality and get this continuity fear, familiarity problem, that we're trying to infer a different self, then the whole issue of inferring, we're afraid to stop inferring completely. So we see a world that infers reality instead of a world that infers a change in reality. So you see the difference here. This is the option we have. Now we can see, why did we stop the news? Why did we and pay no attention to the world, really? Because, again, narrative automatically gives rise to inference. It does automatically gives rise to inference. Then we don't realize we're trapped in this. Yeah, you could say it's like a trap that we don't recognize what the trap is. Is any narrative at all automatically is inferring, is calling forth inference, inferring that this must relate to some a change in reality, a changed self, changed reality. And we become familiar with all of this, subtly not recognizing how we seem to be. This familiarity brings up fear in letting go of it. It's a very subtle trap, you might say. So when everyone's screaming here, we're trapped, we're trapped, we're trapped. Well, I responded to that and trying to help with that. And it is, you might say, it's this subtle trap of inference. And then we say, well, but we can't drop narrative altogether. That's too frightening. I mean, the whole structure of narrative, we'd be a complete vanishment of what we're used to arising. So that's where the Holy Spirit comes in and says, yeah, that's true. So that's too much of a continuity leap for you. So we'll just have a vision of a realm that infers reality, which is nothing imperiled at all. So there's really no narrative there happening at all. Everything is flawless, everything is perfect, nothing can be harmed at all, nothing can be changed at all. So the narrative that we're used to of all this change and impermanence and imperilment and all this doesn't exist there. And yet there is an inference of something which we would say it's inferring reality. So we're working through this belief that we're trapped by taking a close look at this. Are we really trapped? Well, if we're ignorant, it will feel as though we're trapped because we don't understand this inference that's automatically taking place constantly in our lives as we believe we have a life. We believe we have a world. We believe that we have these narratives. We believe this is need. We have this need. Then inference is arising continuously along with this, inferring that there's some self that this needs to be applied to. And we just have to keep working at this until the self emerges or is born out of this inference, the will to inference, to infer, the will to infer that there must be a self that all this applies to, a story. The story must apply to the lead character, the protagonist. We say, well, it has to apply to it, doesn't it? And we think it needs to, but it doesn't apply to anything. It's much ado about nothing. It's like we're staging a play, and we realize that the play is really doesn't have any plot at all. And then we say, "Oh gosh, well, we don't want to drop all this staging. We have all this wonderful staging we created to try and infer a plot, infer a protagonist." Well, the Holy Spirit says, "Not a problem. We'll keep the staging. We'll transform it into this beautiful, beautiful, invulnerable staging. No imperilment to it all, and then you can just enjoy the plot is just to enjoy the staging." That's that at that point, it's just enjoy the staging. That would be the plot, and this staging then infers the enjoyment of reality as it is. And we don't need to come up with a name for this, because that's inference. We don't realize the intellect is inference. The intellect says, "Well, what does this infer? What does this infer? Where is this inference leading? What is it leading to? It's not leading anywhere." By Longchenpa in his reading, it gives that feel of that, right? It's not leading anywhere. So we're flipping the script. We're not regurgitating. We're flipping the script here as the wow reverberates. It's a fine line between regurgitating and flipping the script. And the line, how do we do this? Well, we feel the wow, and if we start trying to regurgitate, it feels wrong. It feels wrong in us. So if we're feeling this wow, we can work on flipping the script effectively because we say, oh, that doesn't cause a problem with the wow. Okay, then that's okay. If I start feeling I'm going the wrong direction, I catch myself and stop. Say, well, that doesn't feel quite right. So really, it is a feeling. You have to feel this wow. And then this, we ask, well, how do we know, you know, how to proceed? Well, the wow tells us. The wow is this reverberation that evaporates the continuity fear. And so as this is reverberating, we can take a look at this and that and work on flipping the script, all the while feeling this reverberation, making sure nothing interferes with this reverberation. The wow reverberation. This is why it's so important not to override this wow feeling with drugs of any kind, with any activity, whatever it is. This is why the Bacchanalian activities of the pagan religions are not appropriate or effective at all. Very, very ineffective. You have to be quiet, have to be calm, you have to be aware of the reverberation of this wow, and make sure that that there's a full stop in this wow, in this allowing the reverberation to have its digestion of the spiritual food to have its effect. Don't regurgitate it. And this is the time-tested, time immemorial tested way, the quiet, the calm, the still, the non-action, to allow this overall pragmatic effectiveness to take root and to be effective. It will always be that way. We're in this time now where we keep thinking that radical changes are happening to everything. No, they're not. It's happening to everything. They're not. The continuity fear, this problem of familiarity, isn't being changed at all by through some electrical gadget. It doesn't do anything to it. And we're under this delusion that we could somehow change continuity fear the way we've changed communication here, or graphics, or this, you know, technology has changed these different fields in some way, a little bit here and there, really. But it doesn't touch upon continuity fear at all. No technology will ever touch upon continuity fear. We'll never touch it. And so this is why I say we're in this extremely dangerous situation now with artificial intelligence, believing in that instead of this, the spiritual path of what has to be done. Full stop in the wow, the reverberation of wow. Flipping the script, working on assertions, and allowing the continuity fear to evaporate in this way. Spiritual food, having to eat this spiritual food every day. Technology can't do it for us at all. That's like saying our hunger is going to be appeased by some robot, you know, feeding a robot some soup or some food. And the robot says, that's good, I feel good. As if that'll take away our hunger, you know, as if that feeds us. It doesn't work that way, obviously. Even more so, it doesn't work that way spiritually. So artificial intelligence is just a side trip, an unnecessary detour into ineffectiveness. Many have been enlightened in the past. They're just sitting quietly like this, doing the necessary work. They didn't even need books, actually. They got it from their teachers. They got it from inner guidance, their teachers. And you don't need some advanced civilization, industrial civilization, technological civilization to do this at all. It's not only is it not necessary, it gets in the way. It breeds false hope. It definitely breeds false hope. And people are just waiting for the right pill for them, the right pill come out, and or the right gadget to come out, and they're just waiting for it, not eating the spiritual food. They're like on a starvation diet. They say, don't worry, the robot will eat for me. I'll be happy. The robot will tell me that I'm good, and I'll feel good. There's no chance of that working at all. Not even, you know, a remote iota of a chance of any of this working like that. And yet we keep thinking that our imagination is so powerful that it can do anything. Well, but the problem of familiarity is the problem everyone overlooks here. Problem of familiarity, which means the continuity problem. Well, we're familiar with inference. How do we drop all inference? We think without inference there won't be any self at all. If we think we're not inferring a self, that there will not be a self. We think we're giving birth to a self through inference. If we stop, we think, oh, I'm not going to give birth to myself. And yet we already have a perfect self. It doesn't need to be born. It already is perfect. Always will be. So this problem of familiarity and inference and continuity problem is in no way is that gotten rid of or erased by technology. That just breeds more inference. Inferring that with computers they'll enable the self to be born. It just breeds massive new inference. This whole technological nonsense breeds terrible, terrible amplification of inference. All of nature too breeds inference. All of our imagining, all of our evaluation breeds inference. And so inference is something, it's the background noise of our, and when we're so familiar with it, we don't feel we wouldn't exist without it. It's kind of like we're not even hardly aware of it. We're so used to it, we just take it for granted that this is not natural, this is normal. It's not at all. It's completely bizarre. But we've taken it as if it were the ground of being, inferring that we've changed the ground of being. This inferring that we've done this, inference from our efforts, we believe that that is reality. And without it, we wouldn't exist. We have no being at all. So of course, this is the problem. The continuity fear issue here, of fear of dropping all this inference. So we keep thinking, and keep generating this inference, thinking, oh my gosh, I gotta keep generating this, or else I won't exist. And of course, imperilment is part of the narrative that's so important for this inference. So we have to identify with the body. We think we need to identify the body and all the body's troubles. And when we forget the body, not identifying with it, we say, "Oh my gosh, what? Okay, I gotta get back to the inference. I gotta keep generating this inference of a self. Yeah, it must be a self because look at the body. It's suffering. All the things it's doing. It has to be for some purpose." So the situation is so profoundly troublesome in terms of this issue of familiarity and oh, we don't want to lose our inference of a self, that even when we experience the true self, we say, but I got to get back to inferring this. You know, it'll disappear without inference, because we realize that the self, an inferred self, doesn't appear at all, and we assume that it takes massive inference to get it to appear. That's an assumption. We think, well, the problem is we just haven't inferred enough. And so we experience the true self, we say, oh, I must have had some successful inference. It finally worked, but I'm not sure how it worked, and I'm sure that this will disappear if I don't keep inferring it. It's based on inference, and in just experiencing it, I've stopped inferring. So I got to get back to inferring again. So inevitably, we detach from the experiencing of our true self and get back to inferring it, thinking that that is what creates it and sustains it, which is very unfulfilling, because then we realize, wait, there's a catch-22 here. I believed I did create a new self there, and I experienced it, but I can't really experience it. It's like a self that I can't experience. And this is our frustration here, is we think, well, we might be able to infer a self, but when we experience what we think it is, that we have to stop experiencing it out of fear that it'll disappear if we don't. So it's very, very frustrating, unfulfilling, this whole scenario that we're engaged in. But when we experience the true self, it's not this self that's based on inference or narrative inferring that this is applying to some self. It's not based on any narrative whatsoever. So we don't need to go back to narrative and say, oh yeah, you know, what was the narrative that I managed to infer that there's this self? And Longchenpa points this out, of course, in this chapter so well. very, very, very key. It's spot on from my experiencing. It is really spot on. And of course, our goal is abidance in the true self, instead of going back and saying, oh boy, what kind of narrative gave rise to it? And I forgot. Well, I'm not sure which one it was, or what was I thinking? Well, what happens was we stop thinking that any narrative is necessary, and narratives don't matter in the slightest bit. So the idea, well, what were you thinking? What narrative led to this inference is a false question. I realize that the self doesn't have a narrative. It's not inferred, it's inherent. It's inherent from the inherent isness, and there's no narrative that leads to it at all. No narrative that gives rise to it, that infers it. There's no inference involved at all. None whatsoever. Now, inferences can still be there, but you realize that they have nothing to do with the self at all. So the world can still be there. It's like inferring that a rope is really a snake, and then using the snake as inferring that it applies to some other self. We can realize, oh, it's the true self. It doesn't need any inference at all, and yet we can still see an inference of a snake and say, well, that doesn't have anything to do with as much ado about nothing. It's just an empty narrative involving an empty inference. Something like that. So abidance is the key, is the goal. And having experience with this, I'm looking at what are the factors that divert us from abidance, and this one we're getting, you know, really getting to it here. There's no question about it. We're getting to it. How much we're getting to it, hindsight will reveal it. But we are getting to it. One day, all of us will have an experience of abidance, and we'll say, "Oh my gosh, this is it!" And then we'll say, "Okay, well, wait a minute. I mean, what narrative finally gave rise to this self?" And then we'll then go back to looking within narratives. We'll say, "What's it this?" And we'll have to gradually recognize there wasn't any narrative. The self is not something that arises. We keep looking for a self that's going to arise out of a narrative. There isn't any such self. And we think, well, all this creativity was for nothing. Well, it was just for creativity is always for its own sake, our own enjoyment. It doesn't give rise to anything. It's just for our adventure and our enjoyment. So we honor our creativity. Holy Spirit honors our creativity by showing us that which infers reality, you might say. With just a steady narrative, a still narrative, a beautiful. Just a narrative that is just enjoyment of beauty. That's it. Inferring reality from that. That's along these lines. We're really digging here, digging. Like an archaeological dig, and we're discovering the bones here. No question about it. It's like careful, like an archaeological dig. We don't want to hurt the bones, and we use our little whisk brooms and compressed air and all these little tools, little toothpicks or whatever they use, little dental picks to gradually reveal what are the bones, what are the trouble, what's the trouble that's been torturing us, really. And it seems like we've gone even further now to recognize this here. We have not been aware of that we're inferring. We've been inferring continuously for so long now. Continuously inferring. Without, it's that lack of inference that we're unaware that that it's even there. It's like the air we breathe. We take it for granted, but when we experience the true self, that inference is not there anymore. We see something's different. You know, what? And then we say, oh my gosh, you know, the very ground of what we think of our being seems to have disappeared. I mean, then we say, I got to get back to that. And then we choose that, and then poof, our awareness of the true self is gone. This is how it happens. We don't want to over-explain it because we let the wow reverberation do its work. This is, we've brought it to light, you know, the bones are there, we can see them. It's like, wow. So just let it reverberate. It lost another pound on the scale. It's like, what? 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 Oh my gosh, but then you start getting greedy. And then, so it's actually, it's funny, it's so difficult to diet. Success, you feel great, but then you get greedy. And say, oh my gosh, I need to lose at least this much more, and how am I going to do that? That's going to be too difficult. And so it flips into a negative mode pretty easily. It's kind of like the spiritual path. It's easy to flip into a negative mode because you say, oh, I made such great progress, but oh, I still have this very important progress to make, and how am I going to do that? Well, we try not to think about that. We try just to accept the progress we've made right now and don't get ahead of ourselves. So if we lose weight, it's like, that is great. Now let's see if we, you know, is it possible to hold that weight, at least hold it, or if I go up a little bit, well, at least I'm getting familiar with this weight. And that's a large part of dieting, actually, is getting used to the new weight. I find that if you start feeling too light, I find we start getting jittery. And we say, well, I better eat something. I feel a little too light. And then we put the weight back on. So we literally have to become used to functioning at a lighter weight. Otherwise, we'll actually start eating too much and gain the weight back. So this is why it takes a lot of discipline. Same as the spiritual path, a lot of discipline to hold the line and say, yeah, let me just get used to this. Let me just try to stay at this weight. Be very careful here. Don't eat too much. Once I get used to it, I feel this is my normal weight now. As I call it, the new norm, the new normal. We have every day we have to keep working at the new normal. Once I feel this is my new normal, then from there, I say, oh, I can drop a couple pounds from this normal. That's not a problem. It'll seem kind of fun. Say, yeah, let's do it. But if we try to go too fast, if we hit these plateaus, which we then end up then going back up to, you know, heavier weight again. This is how it works. It's quite difficult. Dieting is actually quite difficult. I still haven't got to my target weight. And it's been how long? September, October, November. It's been 3 months plus now, going over December 3rd. But I'm sticking with it. It's important to just realize there's this difficult process. Just you have to stick with it. And it tests our determination. Same with the spiritual path. It haven't gotten to my target goal yet of abundance. So I have to make sure I don't stray from that too much. And we can say, when we get tempted to go back into inference, we say, well, I feel I have faith the Holy Spirit is going to give me something that also infers, but it's going to infer not a changed self, but an unchangeable reality. But I'll keep the inference. It's not along those lines. And therefore, whatever arises to tempt you, just say, well, I don't have to be tempted. I understand the principle of inference and how I want that still. And just have faith that something will arise for us that will be beautiful. It hasn't arisen for me yet, but my life has trended towards being put into very beautiful surroundings to give me at least some echo, a foretaste, as it were. This is the videos I made of the waterfalls and palm trees. It's an echo. It's like a foretaste of some beautiful inference that this is what Jesus tells us, that we have this, the real world. I call it the death-free, it could be called the death-free realm, the real world. It's a beautiful, beautiful inference. Indescribably beautiful, he calls it. Which is based on nature. It's still based on the basic format of that we've imagined of what we call nature. Imaginary compoundment. So don't panic and say, where's the inference? Say, well, just say, you know, I'll get an inference out of this eventually. As long as once I settle into this, I'll have an inference. It'll dawn upon me. You know, just take it easy here. Not panic on this issue. Let it emerge. Now I'd like to get back to those palm trees. And of course, absolutely. Oh my gosh. It's just beautiful is all you can say. There's no utilitarian purpose of it doing for some changed self. It's just beautiful. And I don't particularly tire of looking at that beauty. You just say, wow, this is beautiful. And that's it. But that infers reality. There's an inference of reality of the, Jesus says reality is indescribably exquisite. Our experiencing and there's something about palm trees that they seem timeless. Not that they really are, but there's an inference of that. You see, we had this windstorm here today, and there's a lot of palm trees in a certain area. And what a mess. All of the old palm fronds, the old dead ones, that they all came down. It was just the streets are just littered with them. So, you know, that's not the inference we're looking for, but when they keep the palm trees all trimmed and neat like this, and they're evergreen, and they just seem like nothing, timeless, nothing, they just always look like this. And there's no really any limbs to break or weird angles. If you look at trees and they have all this, like we're looking at the trees today, the storm broke limbs off of trees, and they all kind of go this way and that way. And whereas the palm tree is just as, you know, just as smooth, straight, beautiful, and an evergreen top to it. And it always looks the same. So it gives you a feeling of sameness, smoothness, sameness, unchangeableness, evergreenness. It gives an inference, I find. All these palm trees gives rise to this inference, a very positive inference. And people tend to feel that echoes of. Now this German saying, man cannot always wander under the palm trees. Well, we need to turn that around. That's an egoic statement. Because what they're saying is we got to get to work inferring a changed self. So we can't always spend time inferring reality. Well, yes, we can. Until enough inference has accumulated, enough familiarity with this inference has accumulated, so that then we can actually experience reality as it is. We don't even need to infer it. We drop inference altogether. Drop belief, drop inference, value, evaluating, all that inference, we'll call it for now. Drop it altogether. So we want to wander under the palms until we are able to drop inference altogether. Absolutely, we do. And so I was just wandering under the palm trees, ostensibly taking video. So people say, what's he doing? Oh, he's a tourist taking video. Okay, he's not just like, well, you know, gawking at the palm trees, but really I'm gawking at the palm trees. Yeah. And just feeling, hey, wow. This seems to be inferring something that I really like. This evergreen place, this place that doesn't seem to be touched by storm or mishap or everything. And of course, they keep the palm trees well trimmed there, so it gives this impression. It's a powerful impression, powerful inference. Whereas here, all the trees are just this mishmash of branches, and it's terrible. I don't like it at all. This infers imperilment, change self. No, that's not a good inference. And golf courses, I dig up golf as an excuse, get out of golf courses, because that gives a powerful inference too towards reality of it's evergreen, it's always green, everything is neat, everything is clean, nothing's ever happened out here to damage anything. Of course, they make it look that way, they put a lot of work into it. But it does produce a rather powerful inference to reality. And so I want to at least be, you know, good enough at golf so I can say I can go out on those courses. So I keep working at it and try not to let it lapse. I had a struggle, a little bit of a struggle last time, I guess you could say. It's like, wow. But just let's get out there. And the problem with wild, untamed nature, it gives the wrong sort of inference. It tends to heighten the inference about a changed self based on imperilment. Like if you go into the Sierras, it's just this, wow, it's just so much evidence of massive geotectonic activity and destitution and dying and struggle to exist. And, you know, it gives the powerful inference to all that. So I don't really like that. I don't like the inference that comes from it. But the inference is powerful. There's no question. People like to go into wilderness because it gives a powerful inference. It sure does. But it's the wrong kind. It's the wrong kind of inference. It's the way of keeping inference because they're not aware that there's this intermediate step of the Holy Spirit that provides for us of a beautiful realm of non-imperilment, a beautiful vision of non-imperilment, that a beautiful inference back of reality instead of a belief in changed reality. So beautiful palm trees and waterfalls. I just like to just sit there and say, wow, this really reminds me. I like the inference of this. I really do. And you know, you don't have to do anything. You just hang out there. You can act like you go swimming, you go golfing, you do this. But it's just, you're really soaking in this inference. And I felt it coming back here to the Silicon Valley. It gives all the wrong inference. I said, oh my gosh, this is terrible. This is terrible. I felt this very dark feeling coming back in the Bay Area. I said, I don't like this place at all. So it gives the wrong inference. The people live here, it gives a powerful inference, but the wrong direction. But those who are still, you know, trapped in their arrogance and continuity fear, they think this place is great, greatest place in the world, because they're getting a powerful kick of inference here. They certainly are. But I feel like, wow, this is the wrong kind of inference, for sure. So why am I here? I don't know. I mean, it's just an outlier. It's an anomaly almost at this point. I'm feeling like this is too anomalistic. I don't really belong here at all. This is not the right inference I'm trying to draw. So I just keep putting in the hands of the Holy Spirit and hoping this works. I don't, but by clarifying this more and more, I'm sure it's helpful. I become very, very aware of this. And hopefully we, you know, more of us can get with this and understand it. That we cannot just radically dispense of inference like that. I know there's maybe some teachers who think that's possible. No, it's not really. They don't really do it themselves. And we shouldn't have to. Why should we? What are we trying to prove? We should honor our creativity. There's no need to radically dispense of it. We can honor our creativity through inference. Keep the inference there so we can honor our creativity. But inference reality. Absolutely we can. And so, you don't even have to play golf. You can go to these clubhouses. My God, I mean, next time I just look to visit clubhouses and just hang out and have lunch and just soak it up. It's beautiful. So it's not just about the flipping the script and the assertions in the wild. I mean, we can apply this to this echo of inference of reality. This is also part of our path, actually. It's been part of my path all along. Since we have this massive play of inference and massive play creativity, we're not going to just drop our creativity and just throw it aside and say, ah, it's all terrible. We love our creativity. Jesus is pointing this out to us. We no matter how terrible the nightmare, we still love our creativity in producing the nightmare. So most definitely, we will need to, not need to, but pragmatically, we would like to accept an inference of reality, and we need to, we would like to move in that direction. We would prefer to move in that direction. Let's put it that way. We don't really have any needs. So let's try to use the term, the terminology, like prefer. I would greatly prefer to move in that direction. Holy Spirit, hello. Yeah, hello. Gosh. Yeah, let's just caravan down or something. Let's just caravan. I mean, there's got to be a way to do it. Let's start doing it in some respect. Gosh. Maybe Christmas time. Let's all caravan down. Just spend some time wandering among the palms. People say, why are you doing that? You know, why don't, what do you infer? How does that help you infer, you know, a changed self? It doesn't. It helps us infer an unchangeable self. Inherently fundamental, unchangeable reality. It's hard to guess the age of palm trees, too. They seem like they've been there forever. It's just the way it is. So, keep pray for it. Pray for it. Pray for it. Let's pray for it. Let's just ask the Holy Spirit for it. I keep asking the Holy Spirit for it, trying to dial this in here. Where there's the whole, where the Holy Spirit is involved, there's a way. Makes a way where there seems to be no way. So, okay. How are we doing here? Very great. So, there is something to be said about wandering among the palms. It's powerful. Powerful, powerful, powerful inference. Lushness, the greenness, something that it just seems like it's always been this way, it's always will be this way, it's never going to change, it's just, this is how it is, it's, you know, it's just, it infers reality. Yeah, okay. We'll see how this goes, we'll see how this sets in. I don't know. I'm feeling like it's very intense. I'll get ahead of myself. Okay, very great. This has been very profound. That's enough food, spiritual food for this one. That's it.